good morning, and I'm so glad to have you checking in again here as you start or end your day, perhaps, in the Word of God. And we are working our way through the book of Acts, and we're in Acts chapter 19. We're going to start in verse 30 and go through verse 34 today, and this is continuing an encounter that Paul had in Ephesus when the crowd was stirred up by Demetrius, trying to preserve and protect their livelihood at the expense of life, really. They are rejecting the gospel because they want to, what they love and cherish more are the comforts of the world. And so they are really going nuts because they seem to think that the great goddess Artemis is threatened by the gospel. And so the crowd has been stirred up, and they chant, "Great Artemis, great is Artemis," the Ephesians, over and over and over and over again. And so we're going to pick up here in verse 30 in just a second. Let's pray together first, please. Oh, Lord Jesus, help us to find and know our peace, our joy, contentment in you. To know that nothing and no one satisfies as you do. For you are the one who made us, and you know what satisfies. Let us be at peace with you. Even, Lord, as we live sadly at odds with the world and the pattern of the world and the priorities of the world, the pursuits and passions of the world, help us, O God, to love you and cherish you, even as we live in the world, God, seeking to make you known. And help us to understand how to engage and how to disengage at times from this warfare and this battle. As we study this text this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Acts 19, starting in verse 30. Remember, the crowd is stirred up and filled with confusion, chanting over and over and over again, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." Verse 30. But when Paul wished to go in among the crowd, the disciples would not let him. And even some of the Asiarchs, who were friends of his, sent to him and were urging him not to venture into the theater. Now some cried out one thing, some another, for the assembly was in confusion, and most of them did not know why they had come together. Some of the crowd prompted Alexander, whom the Jews had put forward, and Alexander, motioning with his hands, wanted to make a defense to the crowd. But when they recognized that he was a Jew, for about 2 hours they all cried out with one voice, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." Sometimes it is not in the Lord's will and plan for us to engage in the futile endeavor to try to rationalize with the crowd. Paul, ever eager to never back down from the opportunity to proclaim the gospel and to engage the lost and the broken with the gospel, is wanting to go out into the crowd, but they hinder him because Paul would be ripped to pieces. And so serious were they in wanting to hinder Paul that even some of the Asiarchs, these are people that are natives of that land, they are this is where they come from, that have become believers, not only those that are Paul's traveling companions, but even locals are trying to convince him to not go out into the theater. And this is where they had gathered. They gathered in the theater in Ephesus. There's an archaeological spot there even today that you can see this theater that was devoted to the great goddess Artemis. And so they protect Paul against this particular futile fight. And sometimes there is a time to step away. Sometimes there is a time to not engage. That is really hard to do in our age of social media. We just feel like every time someone says something on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram that is wrong or offensive, we have to call them out. Really, we don't have to. Sometimes it's okay to let error and untruth and ignorance lie. We actually do more harm than good by stirring up the pot of this error. So they're seeking to protect Paul from the fight, but then also notice this conflicting confusion goes viral in Ephesians, to kind of use in Ephesus, to use a term of going viral. Verse 32, some cried out one thing, some another, for the assembly was in confusion and most of them did not know why they had come together. Rarely when a crowd comes together do they come together with a coalesced, consistent message. Most often a crowd will come together because of an event or the rumor or the wildfire testimony of an event, whether accurately passed along or not. It's kind of like the telephone game, you know. You start with a message here and you go around the circle, and by the time it comes around, the message is all garbled up. But we know that something happened and we need to act out against it. And here, it's kind of like the telephone game. There isn't a cohesive and consistent, clear message that they are acting against, and therefore, there's no coherent, clear, and consistent message that they're acting for. And so some are crying one thing, others are crying another. And it says the assembly was in great confusion. Most of them did not even know why they had come together. That's another reason why it would be futile to engage in the crowd for Paul here. And sometimes it's futile to not engage in debate, argument, disagreement, because of the confusion is of such a nature that this is not the best or the right time. The third lesson from this is in verse 33. Some of the crowd prompted Alexander, whom the Jews put forward, and Alexander motioned with his hand and wanted to make a defense to the crowd. A lot of times, the crowd will want to pull in and pull the strings of public officials to kind of either get their way, the crowd, or to shut the crowd down. And so somebody pulled Alexander in there, and Alexander trying to intervene. This is an example of how futile it would have been for Paul. They pull him forward, and he motions with his hands. He's trying to get the crowd to calm down so they would give him a hearing. And so notice that when we are at odds, when we are at a loss for getting what we want, particularly as a crowd, or we are at a loss for being able to stifle and calm down a crowd, you usually try to call in authorities. And this doesn't usually go very well. And here it doesn't go very well, because in verse 34, we learn that this crowd is unceasingly and uncontrollably bent on just pursuing their mob mentality. Verse 34, when they recognized that he was a Jew, not a good thing, because the Jews, although lived there, were being linked with this troublesome guy, Paul, because they were standing against the great goddess Artemis. When the crowd recognized that he was a Jew, they continued on. Look, hear this. 2 hours of chanting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." 2 hours. You begin to see and understand how unbelievably out of control this crowd was. And so sometimes, my friends, sometimes, and this is a hard lesson for me, because I always want to engage people out of compassion, out of love, out of a longing to bring clarity to their understanding, to bring the truth of the gospel to bear on their lives. And sometimes it is not the right time to engage in it. Sometimes to try to engage in the crowd or the debate is actually an act of futility. They're not in a place to even hear, let alone comprehend and receive the truth. And this is not abandoning posts. This is not abandoning responsibility. There is that form of not engaging. But in this time, sometimes we just need to hit the pause button and wait for things to calm down and clear out. And that's what Paul's going to do. Paul will eventually re-engage in not just Ephesus, but in all the endeavors of the gospel. And so sometimes it is the time to step away and recalibrate and re-concentrate on what it is that we need to do. And so I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what you're going through, maybe perhaps what battles or challenges you're facing. And there is a time and there is a purpose under heaven for all things, as the writer of Ecclesiastes said. There is a time for war and there is a time for peace. In other words, there is a time to engage in the battle of preaching and proclaiming the gospel and advocating for the truth of the gospel. There is a time to step back and not engage in that. And so what we need to do is we need to seek the Lord in prayer and ask the Lord, what time is it? Is it time to go or is it time to stop and wait? So may we be those who seek the Lord and ask Him what time it is and be faithful to Him first and then faithful in living out the hope and the love of Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Father, help us. Some of us are naturally bent on being combative. We are. It's easy for us to take a stand. It's easy for us to share our opinions. It is easy for us to correct and challenge others. And then there are others of us as people pleasers, God, that's a very challenging, hard thing to do. Help us, O God, one, to know what it is that You want us to do, and to give us the strength and the faith and the perseverance to do, God, as You lead and prompt us. If it is time to speak up or if it's time to be quiet, lead us, as always, that we would bear witness to the one true living hope that is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray, Jesus, in Your name. Amen. Well, may the Lord be with you, and may the Lord apply this word to your life, specific maybe to your circumstances. I look forward to hearing how God answers your prayer today. I'll see you again tomorrow.